Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our CJS Thursday lecture series. My name is Reginald Jackson, and I'm director of the Center for Japanese Studies here at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. And I'm also associate professor of pre-modern Japanese literature and performance in the Department of Asian Languages and Cultures here as well. I'm so happy to see you all. Is this any better? Yeah, sure. Sure, I thank you for that suggestion. Hello, this is me speaking more slowly and louder. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate it. I understand that we're all trying to be safe, and I appreciate that the staff have worked hard to kind of ensure this as well. It's my sincere pleasure to be able to welcome you to this first in-person session of our CJS Thursday lecture series with Dr. Ryan Masaaki Yokota. I'm very excited to introduce you to today's speaker, but first I'd like to give some announcements. Please join us next week for our next talk, which is entitled Racism, Mestizaje, and the American World War II Ethnic Cleansing of Latin American Japanese, which will be given by Jessica A. Fernandez de Lara Harada, who is another of our 2022-23 postdoctoral fellows here at the Center for Japanese Studies at the University of Michigan. This lecture is also going to be co-sponsored by the University of Michigan Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies as well. Also, we'd like to encourage you to please check out our CJS events page or various social media for CJS lectures scheduled for fall of 2022. Also, please mark your calendars for the evening of October 13th when CJS will be collaborating with the Michigan Theater to bring you a screening of the 1926 avant-garde film, A Page of Madness, featuring a live onstage narration by a professional benshi visiting from Japan. This is Nanako Yamauchi. The Detroit-based musician trio Little Bang Theory also composed an original score for this film, and they will be performing it live on stage as well. So it'll be a real treat. Admission is free, and we hope to see many of you there. And I'm grateful to my colleague, Marcus Nornes, for being instrumental in helping to plan that. It's been a lot to put together, but we're really excited that you'll be able to join us. For those of you who are attending this particular lecture via the webinar online, please note that webcams and microphones have been muted, but we do invite you to use the Q&A function during the lecture to submit any questions you might have, the button at the bottom of your screen there, and the presenters will try to address as many of those as possible. Since this is a hybrid format, we'll be taking questions live. Our colleague Yuri Fukuzawa will be taking those questions, and I'll be on my computer to kind of to field the questions that are coming in digitally. So we'll try to make sure that we get questions from both venues. Please also notice that the live transcription or closed caption function is also available for those of you on coming in online, and it will be enabled if you'd like to rather not have it. You can just go to the right corner of your screen to disable that. Otherwise, keep in mind that when you're submitting questions online via the Q&A function, please try to keep them succinct for the sake of everyone so that we can kind of get those out, and it'll help the speaker as well when he's trying to answer. So with that all said, without further ado, it is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Ryan Masaaki Yokota, one of our two 2022-23 postdoctoral fellows for the Center for Japanese Studies here at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. Dr. Yokota received his PhD in East Asian History with a focus on Japan from the University of Chicago with a dissertation entitled Okinawan Postwar Nationalisms, Independence, Autonomy, and Indigenousness, 1945 to 2008. Dr. Yokota earned a Master of Arts in Asian American Studies from the University of California, Los Angeles with a thesis entitled Gambatte Ando, A History of the Okinawan Peruvians in Los Angeles, having graduated with a BA from the same institution in History and English, American Studies, specializing in Asian American Studies. As a member of this committee, when the Postdoctoral Fellowship Selection Committee reviewed the dozens of applicants from around the world who had applied, we were all incredibly impressed by the quality of Dr. Yokota's scholarship, but also the wealth of teaching experience and experience moreover he'd had within the world of Asian American activism. Besides the analytical acumen of his scholarly writing, one of the things that made Dr. Yokota stand out was his longstanding commitment to social justice, activism at various scales and in various locales, Los Angeles, Chicago, and Okinawa among them. He has many publications, some of which include Reversion Era Proposals for Okinawan Regional Autonomy and Rethinking Postwar Okinawa Beyond American Occupation, the Okinawan Uchinanchu Indigenous Movement and Its Implications for Intentional/International Action in AmerAsia Journal from 2015, Gambateando, the Peruvian Nisei Association and Okinawan Peruvians in Los Angeles, and also Transculturation and Adaptation, A Brief History of Japanese and Okinawan Cubans in Afro-Hispanic Review from 2008. This is just a sampling of Dr. Yokota's publications. He's also done a number of invited talks inside and outside the academy related to his research and political commitments to combat discrimination in multiple realms. These include Japanese America, Culture, History, and the Experience of Japanese American World War II Internment Incarceration at the University of Utah Gateway to Learning Educator Workshop in 2021. He was a moderator for the panel Healing and Reuniting in the Era of COVID-19, a very timely topic, Facing Anti-Asian Hate Crimes and Xenophobia in the U.S. at DePaul University in 2021 as part of the Asian American and Pacific Islander Heritage Month Colloquium. He was also a discussant in The Making of Suspect Communities from Japanese Incarceration to the Muslim Ban at the University of Illinois Chicago Global Asian Studies Virtual Colloquium in 2020. Beyond that, he's also been involved in work with local kind of community organizations, such as the North Shore Baptist Church in Chicago, where he was a guest panelist giving a talk entitled Human Rights Without Borders, Immigration and the Legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. And last but not least in this vein, he was an organizer and moderator for Hate Crimes from Vincent Chin to the Present, Then They Came for Us, Incarceration of Japanese Americans During World War II and the Demise of Civil Liberties, for the Alphawood Gallery Symposium in Chicago in 2017. Again, this is only a smattering of Dr. Yokota's various engagements. In terms of his media engagements, he's also served in a number of roles, many of which allow him to engage broader international audiences. He's been a regular contributor to historical articles to the website Discover Nikkei from 2016 to today, the Ryukyu Shimpo, where he's been an occasional contributor of articles to Japanese language, to Japanese history and language scholarship related to Okinawa, the Japan Times, Nikkei Chicago, and also as a member of the Asian Left Forum, where he worked in national organization that sought to organize Asian Pacific Islander leftists and promote discussion and dialogue on domestic and foreign issues. Beyond this, he also, I thought this was particularly interesting, worked for KPFK, or the Asian Pacific Islander Collective, where he was a co-producer of Radio Bomb, a radio show highlighting Asian Pacific Islander electronica and turntablist artists and urban dance music. So it's incredibly rare to encounter a scholar who can move between teaching college courses on the Korean War and post-civil rights Asian America on the one hand, while also contributing to community outreach and fundraising on the other. To head towards the conclusion, I want to give him his just due. So please forgive me for saying so much about what you've done, Ryan. But he's also served as the Japanese American Service Committee Development and Legacy Center Director, in which among his many accomplishments, he also wrote grants and fundraised over $500,000 in grant awards to help support that foundation. He also coordinated Legacy Center archives related to Japanese Americans in Chicago, Illinois. And then he also served as webmaster for the Gopher Broke Educational Foundation, which is also a larger database related to the history of World War II and Japanese American veterans. So to conclude, I also want to just mention that he's also served as the executive producer for the 2020 film, Resettled Roots, Legacies of Japanese Americans in Chicago. So between radio, film, contributing to newspapers in Okinawa, in Chicago, and elsewhere, and teaching a range of courses, Dr. Yokota is truly a formidable educator, interlocutor, and ally. That's all to say that Professor Ryan Yokota has earned a wealth of knowledge and experience across an impressive range of contexts, both outside and within the academy. We're therefore very lucky to have him join us here at the Center for Japanese Studies to teach our students, contribute to our scholarly community, and help us rethink what Japanese studies can and should be as we revisit the legacies of the past 75 years. I'm therefore incredibly excited to learn from Dr. Yokota as he helps us imagine the futures our center might pursue, and how best to expand and improve the field of Japanese studies more broadly. Today, Dr. Yokota, will be presenting a talk entitled Okinawan Independence and Autonomy Debates in the 1980s. So with that said, please join me in welcoming CGS Postdoctoral Fellow, Dr. Ryan Masaaki Yokota.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Professor Jackson, for this probably a too nice introduction, I might say. I'm very glad to be here. And I wanted to begin just by thanking all of the attendees who are present, as well as all of the faculty and staff of the University of Michigan Center for Japanese Studies. I have been nothing but welcomed with warm arms in my time here. And I'm very grateful to all of you for having this opportunity to be able to talk a little bit about some of my research. I'd also like to acknowledge the Japan Foundation and the Hosei University International Fund Foreign Scholars Fellowship for funding my research at Waseda University and at the sadly now defunct Ryukyu Okinawa Kenkyujo and at the Hosei University Institute for Okinawan Studies. My research under these fellowships really proved pivotal in terms of helping me to develop this research area. So I wanted to thank them for that support. I should also mention that this talk is just a smaller portion of a section on Okinawan nationalism that I am developing for my larger book project, which is focused on Okinawan post-war nationalism and deals with independence movements, movements for regional autonomy, and the recent push to reclassify Okinawan identity as indigenous. So to begin with, I wanted to talk just a little bit about sort of how and where I enter into this discussion. And I think that for me, myself, I come from a particular sort of heritage background. On my father's side, I'm a direct descendant of people who survived the nuclear bombings of Hiroshima, and also of people who were incarcerated in the United States in the Japanese American incarceration sites. On my mother's side, I have relatives who came from Okinawa and survived the Battle of Okinawa, and then also have relatives from Fukushima. So all of these family factors for me really helped to inform my interest in these kinds of subjects. And really at the time in which I was exploring my personal identity, there was a dearth of information about Okinawan history written in the English language, and even in the Japanese language, it was somewhat limited at that early period of time in the early 1990s. And I was able to, through my academic pursuits, begin to investigate a little of this history. And it just so happened that my investigations preceded the very horrible 1995 rape incident in Okinawa, which of course became an international cause and a point of controversy in the US-Japan security relationship. And after that time, I was a young activist and became involved with an organization known as the Okinawa Peace Network of Los Angeles. And we helped sponsor women's delegations coming to the United States, part of sort of people's or citizens' diplomacy to try to affect change in relation to these kinds of issues. And so really beyond, however, the US-Japan security relationship and beyond the issue of the military bases, which of course remains an incredibly pertinent and important issue in Okinawa, I began to kind of start to ask questions about what it is that makes Okinawa so different, why it is in my family that we often sort of talked in sort of hushed tones, like, oh, you're actually part Okinawan, but no one could really tell me what that exactly meant. And, you know, I wanted to try to find out exactly what that meant. In those investigations, I began to learn a little bit about this discussion of a term that was, that many people attribute to the scholar Arasaki Moriteru. And that phrase is izakaya nationalism, which is sort of an offhand or off-color kind of joke along the lines of like, if you get enough Okinawans in an izakaya drunk, that eventually they'll start talking about the golden days of the Ryukyu Kingdom and the desire to form an independent Okinawa nation. And I always thought that this was a rather funny way to approach the subject of Okinawan subjectivity. And I wanted to kind of like think about it and really kind of take it seriously. What happens if we actually do try to tease out the particular history of Okinawa in relation to these questions of nationalism, and really ask the question of what it looks like and how it formed and what are the particular histories that inform it. So in terms of my project, this is primarily an intellectual and social history. And the theoretical underpinnings of this study primarily deal with concepts of sovereignty, colonialism, nationalism, decolonization, and autonomy and secession as they apply to Okinawan history. In addressing these issues, this talk will primarily focus on two proposals that were published in the Shin Okinawa Bungaku Journal, which I loosely group under the term, quote unquote, nationalism. Though, as we will see, the question of what constitutes this nationalism remained an object of debate and much contention. This talk will not be focused on proposals for jichi or regional autonomy, which are here defined as those movements focused on seeking greater regional autonomy under the Japanese nation state. And nor will this discussion deal with questions of Okinawan indigenousness. However, if you have an interest in those, I do have other published works that do address these issues. That said, it is important to recognize that some proponents of jichi can still be proponents of independence, but see the promotion of jichi or regional autonomy either as a preliminary step towards reaching a larger nation state or as sort of a politically expedient means. I wanted to kind of start very briefly and hopefully quickly to provide some grounding for this discussion with a couple of touchstones. And basically to ask this question of, you know, what is happening in this time period in the 1980s between the reversion and between the 1995 rape incident in Okinawa, and also to kind of contextualize this in relation to Japan in the 1980s. And the other thing that I'm hoping to do is to really highlight through this work my intervention in the field by bringing attention to these independence debates in the 1980s, which are, I think, largely overlooked. So the first touchstone really has to do with Japan and Okinawa from the post-war to reversion. And as many of you are here, are students of Japanese history, this is all quite familiar. The occupation of Japan from 1945 to 1952, the alignment of Japan with US interests, particularly in the context of the Cold War, and of course, the Article 9 Constitution, which prohibited Japan from maintaining military forces, normalized military forces, and renouncing war as a sovereign right of the nation, all of which, of course, aligns the Japan with the United States and, of course, with issues such as military troop locating. The Ryukyu Islands, of course, had a very different sort of history in the post-war period. From 1952 to 1972, for another 20 years, it remained entirely under the control of the United States and the US military presence. And so that they had a much different sort of positionality in relation to the rest of Japan. And it was really within that context of dealing with the continued presence of the US military and the military impacts on local citizenry that eventually there developed within Okinawa a movement to revert Okinawa to Japanese control. And we can see here a picture of the mother of the council related to that work in 1960. Moving into the 1960s, the period of the New Left, it was a very difficult time, one of incredible controversy and activism, and especially in the context of the United States deployment of forces in Vietnam, the question of the use of Okinawa as a set of military bases, especially for either refueling and also rest and relaxation activities for troops, caused incredible burdens on the local population. And we see in this image here, a image of an anti-US military demonstration organized by the Military Base Workers Union in Okinawa in 1969. So that these political activities increasingly not only made the question of Okinawa much more important and salient in the overall picture of East Asian politics. But it also made it very difficult for the United States to continue to deploy its troops from a place like Okinawa. It put pressure on the military to find an actual solution to this Okinawa question, something that had remained a sticking point, especially for the Japanese government, people like Prime Minister Sato Eisaku, who saw the return of Okinawa as completing the post-war process, ending the post-war period. And this recidivism on the part of Japan was primal in terms of the negotiations that took place between him and President Nixon of the United States, resulting in this reversion agreement and eventually in the implementation of reversion itself. Now, once reversion is implemented, of course, it is not entirely welcomed by everyone in Okinawa. Some people did welcome it and some people did not. Many people found that the provisions of the reversion process were quite problematic. We will return to that in a little bit. And then the second touchstone is something I had already touched upon, which was, of course, this 1995 rape incident where a 12-year-old Okinawan schoolgirl was raped by three US Marines. This cause is picked up in a large part by women's groups in Okinawa who serve really to highlight this issue in a very large way. Protests continue to multiply over time, culminating in a protest rally of some 85,000 people, a size which was pretty much unheard of at that period of time in the 1990s. And it also included a prefecture-wide plebiscite opposing the military bases and seeking their removal. And so we have figures from the women's movement. Here on the far left side, you can see an image of Takezato Suzio, a very important figure in Okinawan women's circles, and as well as pictures of the demonstrations that followed, right? All of which highlighted this military base situation that continued in Okinawa as an unfair and unjust burden, where something like 70% of all of the US military troops in quote unquote Japan are actually located and sited in Okinawa. But what happened between these two points in time? It's something that is not covered enough in terms of Okinawan history. And how is it that all of a sudden people were able to mobilize so quickly and in such a large sense in the aftermath of this 1995 rape incident? And what I will argue is that in the 1980s, there was a significant amount of at least thought activity, work by intellectuals, scholars, and activists that began to really re-envision a sense of where Okinawa could fit within a larger global sense. In Japan, we don't get much either really about the 1980s at a certain level. So much of the image of Japan's mainland history is overshadowed by the growth of the bubble economy in the 1980s, the precipitous growth of the stock market leading up until 1990. The boom period of this time was exuberant, to say the least, as well as serving to cause a lot of discussions internationally about the growing power of Japan. The spread of Japanese consumer electronics and automobiles, something I don't have to explain to people here in Michigan, I'm sure. And of course, issues related to trade wars, and of course, related to the acquisition of large high-profile properties by Japanese corporations. In the midst of all of this, you have Prime Minister Nakasone Yasuhiro making remarks in September of 1986. That Japan is ethnically homogenous, you know, a Tanitsu Minzoku kind of story about Japan. And this really was not uncommon. It mirrored an earlier 1980 reports from Japan to the United Nations, which also stated that minorities do not exist in Japan. So certainly from this point of view, Okinawa is not different. It is also not very important to care about what it is that Okinawans are doing in thinking about alternatives to Japanese rule. Now, when we think about these Okinawan independence proposals of the 1980s, there is a larger history going back into the post-war period about Okinawans pushing for Okinawan independence. Although generally these movements tended to be somewhat muted. There were early Okinawan post-war political parties, some of which espoused a desire for an independent Okinawan nation state, or other configurations such as a trusteeship status, et cetera. And some of these were supported, for example, by statements from the mainland Japanese Communist Party, which also early on had expressed some support for Okinawan independence as well. Now, ultimately, however, following the reverse course in the US occupation policies and the heightening of the Cold War, this really put a stop in a large way to some of those earlier pronouncements and limited that growth. And then also in Okinawa, we also see additional movements developing related to the issue of the military bases, most famous of which was the 1956 Shimagurumi Tōso, or All Island Struggle in Okinawa, which was focused on the issue of land rents, again, related to the military issue. So that eventually there began to develop this momentum related to reversion. Some of it was related to the way in which the Amami Islands were reverted to Japan much earlier in 1953. And some of it was also related to the Okinawa Teachers Association, which was a very strong proponent of reversion during this time period and had very good connections with the Okinawan, with the Japanese mainland counterparts that they were in contact with. And these movements, of course, would eventually result in the reversion agreement. And although at the time of reversion, there were some people who did push for independence at that moment in time, it tended to be, again, very limited. Some of the groups that were pushing for independence tended to be much more conservative. This was not very popular at this period of time. So there were a range of different kinds of possibilities. But most people began to see this as really a fait accompli that had been pushed by the larger powers of Japan and the United States. That said, one of the major sort of people, groups of people that pushed against reversion was this a group of people that we call the Hanfuki Ronsha, basically people who supported theories opposing the reversion of Okinawa to Japan. And I wanted to kind of highlight some of them for a second here, because at a certain sense, they are really pushing for a sense of independence. But I want to be exactly clear about what it is that they mean here, because their push for independence is more in terms of more in terms of a cultural kind of national sense, as opposed to a push for the development of an independent state or an independent nation state, right? So we have to be very, very careful, I think, in terms of how we refer to these proponents of Hanfukidon, as, you know, in order to say that, well, you know, it's not exactly true, but it is kind of true to say that they're for independence, you know. So we want to be very clear about what that means. Three people were most prominent in terms of this field of Hanfukidon. The first is a man by the name of Arakawa Akira. Second is Kawamitsu Shinichi. The third is Okamoto Keitoku. And really the common principles of these three were that they were anti-state, anti-national in the sense of anti-Japanese nationalism, anti-authoritarian, and also anti-imperialist in terms of their general position. We can see some of them here in these images. And here is an image of Kawamitsu Shinichi, who we'll come back to in a second. And although I didn't have an image for Okamoto Keitoku, this is one of his works on Japonesha Ron. We can see here the influences of the literary scholar Shimao Toshio, for example, on some of their information. Public opinion polls from the 1970s generally looked at popular expressions of dissatisfaction with the reversion process. When asked, for example, if the Okinawa reversion agreement had met the wishes of local individuals, only 13% said yes and 55% said no, and this is in 1971. Over time, we would see that some of these opinion polls would change a little bit. In 1982, for example, 63% eventually were saying that it was good, but 32% still said that it was bad. And in fact, we begin to see marked evidence of really a rejection of earlier moves within the reversion movement. Here, for example, in 86, a demonstration against the Hinomaru and the Kimigayo, and actually organized by the Okinawa Teachers Association, which is somewhat surprising considering that during the reversion period, they were the strongest proponents of reversion and were very instrumental in institutionalizing the Hinomaru and the Kimigayo in the educational system. So here it is, some 14, 15 odd plus years later, that they're really beginning to reject those kinds of aspects, the performative aspects of Japanese nationalism, one may say. Which brings us to these Shin Okinawa Bungaku Journal constitutional debates. Now, it says Shin Okinawa Bungaku as the title of the journal. And so from that, you might surmise that it deals primarily with literature. But in all truth, this journal did not solely deal with literature. It served as really a focal point for intellectual, creative, and academic activities amongst the sort of leadership, a certain kind of intellectual leadership class within Okinawa. And what I want to focus on are two draft constitutions, which were developed as part of a special issue that was issued in 1981, that kind of give us a sense of different ways that Okinawans were thinking about some of these kinds of questions related to, like, okay, if we are going to be somehow independent, what will that look like and how will that be structured? The first is this draft F of this constitutional debate. It was framed by Kawamitsu Shinichi, who I had mentioned earlier as one of these stalwarts of the Han Fukidon sort of way of thinking. And so despite generally being anti-statist, it might be kind of peculiar to some people to see that he would be involved in drafting essentially a constitution of sorts. I think that really, when we get into the wording actually of the of his proposal, we can see a little bit more about what he was talking about. In his draft F, which was originally an anonymous submission, we can see this sort of poetic and evocative content in it, raising questions about Okinawan subjectivity. And in particular, we can really see a little bit of that anti-state thinking of the Han Fukidon proponents, people like Arakawa Akira, who I mentioned earlier as well. In his chapter one of his constitution, for example, he calls for a Ryukyuan social republic that really is unusual in terms of the way that it looks. Because article one of this chapter states first and foremost that they seek the abolition of the state, and in one stroke, annul all other laws except for the articles of this draft constitution. In article two, he states, therefore the army, police, and any fixed state institutions of control, the bureaucratic system, legal institutions, etc., and all organizational systems that concentrate authority are abolished. The people of the Social Republic must smash the bud of authority in each of their hearts and be watchful, right? He continues on to talk about the innate power of people to govern themselves and includes articles prohibiting the killing of other people, discouraging the killing of animals or the cultivation of plants beyond what is necessary for food, and emphasizing popular consensus in decision-making and the need to provide food, habitation, and clothing for all of its residents. Chapter two details the geographical and political structuration of the Ryukyuan Social Republic as stretching across the Ryukyuan archipelago, with four states or shu to be set up in Amami, Okinawa, Miyako, and in the Yayama Island groups, each with an appropriate autonomous body or chichitai to help to manage administration. According to Article 10 of this chapter, the organization of each autonomous body would be determined by the people, taking into account natural and productive conditions. Direct democracy and large-scale public discussions would be the main method for determining these structures, as well as any other further measures. In addition, membership in this republic would be open to all, regardless of race, ethnicity, gender, or nationality, or even residence in the Central Territories as previously demarcated. They also included provisions for the development of a symbolic flag for the Republic, which would be a single white lily in reference to the Himeyuri students that had been sacrificed during the Battle of Okinawa. Articles 13 through 17 continue on to talk about the social policies of the constitutional draft, including anti-war articles and articles prohibiting any military aircraft and ship from entering the islands, and even requiring aircrafts and ships to gain permission before passing inside the territory. In Article 16, they state that the foreign policy of the Republic would be open to the world, with relations related to military affairs being prohibited, along with any military pacts. Article 17 describes how refugees and displaced persons would be accepted unconditionally unless such people had been related to sort of military command and areas like that. In Chapter 3, it includes articles on a non-discrimination clause, outlawing discrimination again on the basis of race, ethnicity, status, family group, birthplace, etc. Article 19 suggests that land and natural resources would be jointly owned, that private property that violates basic communal rights will not be recognized. Article 20 disallows private home ownership with provisions for allocation of residence rights. Article 22 declares that the relationship between men and women should be fundamentally free and equal, with disputes decided by local autonomous bodies. And further articles relate to labor as being voluntary and subjective and linked to rights of recreation. Freedom of religion would be guaranteed, as well as there would be a number of provisions related to the guarantee of educational access for residents of the Republic and other policies such as that. Eventually in Chapter 4, we see a range of discussions related to political policies, including ideas of direct representation in mass assemblies, the seeking of mutual consent for policies, and the suggestion that police, prosecutorial, and court institutions, or any fixed facilities of the judiciary would not be established. Article 5 focuses on issues related to the environment and finance. And really, in all of these different kinds of chapters and articles in this draft constitution, Kawamitsu's proposal can be seen really as a visionary and idealistic document that relies heavily on a fundamental view of Okinawan human society as having the capacity to self-govern with little to no bureaucratic state apparatus. And though it may seem contradictory to use the constitutional format to set up a societal framework that is not a nation state, Kawamitsu uses this document to express really anarchist views regarding the dissolution of the state and to describe an open society that will not only rely on traditional development, that will not rely on traditional development policies, but will instead focus on public forms of ownership of productive forces. Dispute resolution is largely placed in the hands of mass assemblies without allowances for standing bodies of political or judicial administration. And though it's most likely not meant to suggest a concrete blueprint for political mobilization, instead it hints at what it means to reinvent a form of independence that bypasses the aporia of sovereignty. In sum, though Kawamitsu's perspective can be read as being profoundly utopian, really in nature, it does suggest a pointed critique of the state system that has alienated political power from many ordinary Okinawan residents. Now, I want to continue on to talk about Draft C, which was proposed by an individual by the name of Nakasone Isamu. He was a public employee who had served in the Ryukyu government and in its court systems and became a well-known writer and critic in Okinawa. Nakasone would later pass the judicial exam for the summary court of the Japanese Supreme Court, allowing him to become the first Okinawan to be appointed as a judge at the summary court level. He would eventually work in summary courts in Okinawa, Fukuoka, and Tokyo before his retirement in 2010, and would become active as the co-chair of the Article 9 Association of Bushikawa in Uruma City, Okinawa, basically develops this, his own proposal, basically for a Ryukyu Republic, which includes a number of different kinds of provisions that are similarly evocative when compared against Kawamitsu's draft. In Article 1, for example, he details the forming of this republic by the oppressed people of the Ryukyuan Republic in the context of the worldwide revolution of the poor. And they're having come to the path of acquiring the independence and freedom hoped for after all of these years. Throughout his work, he includes a number of different annotations and footnotes which show where some of his wording is coming from. This one, for example, coming from the Japanese Communist Party's 1946 statements, which had been delivered celebrating the possibility of Okinawa's racial independence. And continues on in Article 2 to describe the federal structure of this republic, which details the foundations of public welfare in addressing the perspectives of the poor, the anti-war position of the people, and the universal nature of the principle of revolution for the poor and the need to work towards eventually forming a united world government based upon these kinds of ideals. He continues on to talk even further about what these fundamental principles of the republic would be about. In it, he talks about a republic of the poor based on the foundation of labor and love, wherein sovereignty is attached. He discusses different kinds of ways in which the Ryukyuan archipelago serves as the visible territory of the Ryukyu Republic, while the lands of Nidai Kanai constitute the spiritual territory, suggesting really an expansion of physical territory into the spiritual and the mythical and the transcendent. Though not having a physical location, Nakasone is referencing of this concept here demonstrates an acknowledgement of Okinawan indigenous religion and spirituality. In Articles 3, he continues on to discuss the concept of territory. Similarly to Kawamitsu, talks about four different states existing in Amami, Miyako, Yayama, and Okinawa, thus adding to his detail of his vision of a pan-Ryukyuan republic, and discusses the primacy of local autonomy and stating that the people of the republic that reside in the surrounding isolated islands have the freedom to be attached to or disassociate with whatever states that are desired. And in this sense, we can really see the way in which he seeks to mitigate the difficulties faced by isolated islands and the need to protect local minorities. Article 4 emphasizes this local autonomy concept even further. Article 6, he addresses the question of official languages, noting that the Ryukyuan language is a matter of free will, and also states that the official languages are Ryukyuan and Japanese. And here, it's not entirely clear whether he's talking about Uchinaguchi or any of the other multiple Ryukyuan languages at this moment in time. It's not totally clear from the context of the statement in terms of what that looks like. But in his annotation, he notes one of the ways in which in 1970, Okinawa Youth League protesters had set off firecrackers in the House of Representatives and had taken that occasion to speak in quote unquote, our traditional Ryukyuan language, and that these protesters were expelled from the chamber under the interpretation of the law that since Japanese was the official courtroom language, that such use of the Ryukyuan language could be grounds for expulsion from the room, right? So in an interesting way, this event really showed, according to Nakasone, that the court's interpretation really is that the Ryukyuan language is not the same as Japanese, as many linguists had been suggesting. And oftentimes we hear within colloquial speech the incorrect way of referring to Uchinaguchi as quote unquote Hogen, or as a dialect of Japanese, even despite the fact that it is completely unintelligible to most Japanese speakers. He further continues on to talk about the possibility of developing a federal flag, includes articles on an anti-war clause and on citizenship, suggesting that really anyone could become a citizen of the Ryukyu Republic or secede from it, and includes a number of other aspects that are much more specific in terms of the denial of the stationing of nuclear, chemical, gas, or biological weapons, and enshrining the right to resistance within this constitutional draft. Ultimately, really, in looking at both of these drafts, there are certain kinds of similarities and differences that I would want to highlight. One of the biggest is that both drafts call for a new form of society that's predicated on the devolution of political power to the broad masses of the people, with democratic rights to be exercised through local autonomous bodies in Kawamitsu's vision, or through general principles of autonomy in Nakasone's proposal. Both proposals recognize the need for discrete territorial demarcations in the Ryukyu Islands along the lines of the Amami, Okinawa, Miyako, and Yayama Island groups. Though Nakasone's proposal is unique in also including a sense of the spiritual landscape of the Ryukyuan territory. Both proposals are adamant in stating their opposition to war, to militarism, and to weapons of mass destruction, with Nakasone emphasizing the right of limitless opposition to such actions by the state or by individuals. And in addition, both proposals envision a much more open sense of societal membership than citizenship, with both proposals eschewing even residence in the islands as a prerequisite for inclusion, and also allowing for the possibility of secession. Yet they also differed in that one opted for really society as the answer, and the other opted for the solution of the state, Nakasone's proposal, for example. But regardless, both of them conceived of the formation of Okinawa and a new sense of an autonomous subject. Overall, in conclusion, hopefully this makes time. Though these proposals may seem strange for us to study, perhaps because they are really, again, utopian in some respects. Some may call them unrealistic proposals. Some may call them thought experiments. Maybe in that respect are not considered to be very important. They were also published in a relatively regional specialized journal with limited distribution. But that said, these drafts continue to have a resonance among Okinawan intellectuals and activists. They still look at some of these proposals today because of what they illuminate, what they challenge, what they propose, in terms of a new sense of Okinawan identity, a national identity that may or may not be connected to a state, but one that is based on a sense of anti-militarism, a rejection of the status quo in terms of thinking about things like global security, and a set of proposals that are innovative in terms of really centering questions of equality, questions of justice, and questions of care. And so really, though these visions, as we can say, are unusual things to study from the point of history, other proposals at the same period of time that I'm not discussing in this lecture are much more strident in terms of developing actual formal charters or other constitutional frameworks, which are not entirely dissimilar in some respects from these proposals. But really, for these thinkers and for people dealing and grappling with these kinds of issues and questions at this time, they really, to me, demonstrate that Okinawa was really a state of mind that was being discussed and was being carried in the hearts of people in Okinawa in different kinds of ways that challenged so many different kinds of aspects of the status quo at all different levels. With that, I'll conclude and open the floor up to any questions from either the audience here or from anyone on the online Zoom format.
Thank you so much, Dr. Yokota, for that really stimulating talk. So at this point, we'll move to the Q&A. We have a healthy audience online, as well as hopefully a healthy audience here as well. So we could start, I guess. Marcus, yeah, you have a question? Yuri will be passing the microphone, so please flag her down if you'd like to ask a question.
Thanks, that was really exciting and interesting. I have a question about Okinawa and other parts of the world. And I'm involved in a project that is looking at the solidarity networks between Japan and Palestine. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious if there was any talk among the Han Fukiron or these other discourses you're looking at about Palestine, or whether there are actually concrete connections as well.
Aspects specifically about Palestine come up in a broad sense within the New Left groups within Okinawa during the period of the 1960s going into the 1970s. Occasionally, you do see certain kinds of references in this regard, maybe a little less to the specificities of Palestine, but for example, making reference to other minority groups within Japan, like the Hisabetsu Burakumin or other groups like the Zainichi Koreans, et cetera. So there is definitely a very strong sense amongst these intellectuals to draw connections with other struggles, to make solidarities, and as activists, sometimes to make actual coalitions and to do joint work. Yeah.
We have a question from a member of the online audience. So this is a question, I'll try to read the question as clearly and slowly as possible, Ryan, for you to hear it. So this is a question from Devinder Bhomik. Hi, Devinder, who asks, is there any overlap between Kawamitsu's constitutional draft and Shimao Toshio's idea of Yaponesha, mm-hmm. which interested Okamoto Keitoku deeply? They both seem to be ways to decenter Japan. That's part one. Yes. Part two is, also, I am curious, since you began your research wishing to understand what accounts for Okinawan difference, what you believe the salient difference is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much, Devinda. Yes, definitely. Shimao Toshio's idea and conception of Yaponesia as a sort of regional kind of discourse is very influential on the Han Fukidonsha and people like Kawamitsu Shinichi. And so definitely we can see those kinds of influences. Now, Shimao Toshio's work is not in and of itself without some controversy in terms of really drawing a lot of its conceptions from people like Yanagita Kunio, whose own, academic work, some people challenge, is really attaching Okinawa to Japan as sort of a Japan, or as some sort of like a sort of activistic leftover of Japan. That said, the embrace of that ideology of Yaponesia still continues till today, and people like Takara Ben, for example, were the famous poet and activist, were also heavily influenced by people like Shimao Toshio and his work. So it resonates. And so I think that regardless of the way in which it sometimes had been connected to ideologies that had supported Japanese empire in a certain degree, that Okinawans have reclaimed this concept and made it their own in different kinds of ways. And I think the second question was...
The second question is, she says, also, I am curious, since you began your research wishing to understand what accounts for Okinawan difference, what you believe the salient difference is.
Well, I'll speak to it from the context of what these individuals are suggesting through this constitution, these constitutional drafts. And it's, to me, the more I was thinking about it last night as I was preparing for this talk, the more and more really revolutionary and provocative it really is. Because if Okinawa is a state of mind, right, and if these proposals are taken to heart by every Okinawan throughout the world, right, you know, and in terms of like what it means in terms of rejecting discrimination, centering the needs of the poor, embracing people from even outside of, you know, what it means to be like heritage-wise connected to Okinawa. For example, in one of the proposals, a suggestion to open up this ideal republic to all refugees around the world and things like that. And regardless of how, you know, pragmatic or possible, you know, some of these suggestions are, what happens if you center those kinds of beliefs as a core aspect of what you perceive of yourself in terms of your national identity, right? If you see that your national identity as an Okinawan is to be against discrimination, is to be open and welcoming, right? As a, you know, when we think about certain kinds of really central cultural phrases within Okinawan culture, like ichariba chode, right? Which means that once we meet, we're like brothers and sisters, right? Regardless of our relations. Or the other major phrase is nuchi dutakara, which says that, you know, life itself is a treasure, right? Then if you like center those kinds of concepts, I mean, you kind of have the possibility of creating a national identity, which is really challenging to many aspects of the status quo, right? And, you know, if you say life is a treasure, then how could you possibly be for war? How could you be possibly be for weapons of war and the stationing of such? How can you possibly be for the status quo in terms of how people conceptualize issues of national security or things like, you know, of that sort? Of course, these scholars are not alone in terms of asking these bigger questions about why it is that we have to accept these existing logics of security. Okinawan women's groups, for example, have been very stalwart in terms of asking us to redefine security for many decades now. And so I think that it's become much more widespread as a general or common sort of framework within Okinawan circles.
Thank you for that. I think we have a question over here.
Thank you so much for that. That was a fantastic talk. I learned so much. And I was just thinking, we're so lucky to have you with us this year. So thank you for being here. I wish I could take your class. My question is about, I think, an element that came up in both of the constitutional drafts you discussed, which is this idea of what I would call open citizenship or welcoming citizenship. And I was really struck by that. You know, I think it's a really interesting strategy to create a constitution that sort of dismantles the idea of a state. Right. How cool is that, right? It's really fun to think about. Yeah. I was wondering if you had an idea who they were imagining might take them up on that kind of citizenship. Was it, like you had said, sort of say Buraku people or Korean Japanese, or was it maybe perhaps a result of thinking about refugees from the Vietnam War? So I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, it's really unclear, and they don't go into a lot of the specifics, but certainly in the context of the time period, Vietnam, of course, ending only a few years before these drafts were put into place. And definitely in that period of time, the question of refugee populations fleeing from Southeast Asia was very prime. Okinawa, of course, placed very close to where some of these refugee flows were moving. So I'm sure that they were probably quite aware of that kind of conception. And so I think they probably, you know, in that kind of sense, seeing the linkages of the Okinawan military bases to the Vietnam War, to the Indo-Chinese conflict, they probably felt a certain kind of sense of responsibility in that regard. You know, it's no coincidence that the US also felt a sense of responsibility and passed the Refugee Act in 1980. Almost the same.
Hey, thank you for that. We have another question from a member of our online audience. This is from our colleague here in art history, Kevin Carr, who says, thank you for your fascinating talk. I was particularly struck by Kawamitsu's constitution that sought to establish a polity beyond a nation-state frame. Yes. This may be outside the scope of your talk, but I wonder if similar moves are continuing today. Is this in tension with or complementary to indigenous movements for constituting new identities beyond or redefining the national frame?
This is a really great question right there. Absolutely. On the one hand, this questioning of the state and the nation state system, which we inherit now from the Han Fukidonsha, is really complicated, I think, this question of independence in a large way. Because what independence, in my point of view, looks like in Okinawa is not sort of the stereotypical canonical view of independence that we saw in the decolonization period of the post-World War period, globally, that is. And so, there are many different kinds of ways in which they're conceiving of their connections. The indigenous struggle and the association of Okinawans with indigenousness is a very core to that reconceptualization, for sure. They are consciously attending United Nations forums as representatives of the Rukyuns. Acknowledge, accept, and embrace the definition of indigenous people, which is predicated upon an acknowledgement of colonialism and of the colonial impact. They're looking at groups like the Ainu, who finally had been recognized as indigenous people of Japan. And they're making solidarities with indigenous groups throughout the world, whether they're in the United States or in other parts of the world. And are finding much more in common with each other than they had thought. And one of the phrases that Takara Ben, this Okinawan poet, had put forward is, when you think about it, within the United Nations, there's only a couple of hundred nation states. But if you think about indigenous, First Nations peoples around the world, there are thousands of them. So if we make solidarity with them, wouldn't that be all the more powerful for us to establish linkages, connections, consulates, and other diplomatic relations, et cetera, with these different kinds of groups. So it is a very provocative way to expand beyond the structures of the nation state.
Thank you so much. I have a question, unless there's someone else. And please, I'd encourage folks that are online, if you'd like to, you can still continue to add questions into the Q&A queue, and we'll pick those up. So I have, we'll talk a lot more, Ryan, but this is really fascinating, and I'm largely ignorant of, unfortunately, my colonized education has kind of left me kind of at a loss. But I'm really curious about the role that poetry plays, or the literary plays, in these kinds of debates and these movements. You mentioned kind of offhand when you were talking about at least one of the people that there's a kind of literary kind of sensibility that comes through in this, even though it's not technically kind of bungaku or kind of literature in a traditional sense, that the journal provides a forum. Yes. But I am thinking about like the work that people like colleague Anne-Marie Shimabuku is doing around Iha Fuyu and these kind of linguists or folks that are really interested in, say, kind of so-called pre-modern antecedents and poetry, the literary, as part of a kind of linguistic project, to kind of recover lost language, but also presumably also as a way to tap into some of these other forms or other kind of forms of imagination with regard to sociality that are effectively kind of quashed by, let's say, a modern kind of move towards imperialism and so forth. So I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about kind of where you might see this. I mean, because on one hand, I see tons of connections to things like kind of indigenous movements, say, of the time, but one of the things that becomes really important there is that anti-statist kind of anti-war thinking is also kind of imagination of a pre-modern sociality that may or may not exist, first of all, but then also the literary forms that actually kind of resist these much more kind of binary thinkings and so on and so forth. So could you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, absolutely. I'm reminded of this quote by Russell Means, who is a key figure in the American Indian movement, who had stated, it is through our culture and our arts that we can speak our truths and not be co-opted by political limitations, right? And I think that Okinawans really have embraced that in a very large way. And it's not just through literature, but also through music. Incredible musicians like Kina Shokichi, for example, or others have been very strong in terms of projecting a sense of Okinawan cultural identity in a moment in time in which, again, their political futures are constrained, where they're alienated from political power around the ability to affect change to these military bases, which is so impactful on their everyday life, right? The arts, I think that, of course, Okinawa having such a long history of cultural development through the Rukyu Kingdom period has a rich culture and sort of reservoir to tap upon in order to kind of like try to bring that into the present and make cultural products that are speaking towards a sense of who they are and the issues that they're dealing with today. So I think that you know, is part of this milieu of artists, intellectuals, scholars, and activists who are in discussion and conversation around these issues.
Thank you so much. I also should have said, I'd encourage students, you know who you are, to not be shy about asking questions, even if they're not, say, as fully formed as you might like. This is also a space to kind of invite you to do that. So, but first we have another question from the audience room.
Thank you. Thank you for the speech you delivered. Realistically and politically, do you see status quo as the most viable alternative for the future of Okinawa? If not, what are the other likely scenarios? Thank you.
It is certainly a difficult conversation or a difficult question. And for myself, I try not to project so much of my personal opinion, because my view is that these decisions are going to be best made by the residents of Okinawa. You know, they are the ones who are dealing with the day-to-day issues the most and will live with the impacts of any particular political changes that might occur. I'll defer to their best judgment in terms of how that plays out. In terms of the possibilities of it, a couple of aspects. One is, lately, I would say in current decades in world history, many people are reticent to talk about new forms of nationalism, right? There seems to be a general unease with new emerging nationalisms and new independence struggles, because of course the reality of the implementation of many of those struggles historically in the world was that they were bloody and they were difficult. And even if something were to be pushed in Okinawa, there would be an untangling which would be difficult and would happen, and it would be a question that would go into families, for example, that are, you know, mixed marriages between a Yamatunchu and an Uchinanchu, a Japanese and an Okinawan person, for example. There might be questions related to, well, now where do we stand, for example? And, you know, some of those kinds of questions are very difficult because, you know, in terms of whether or not, you know, we want to have them, we need to have them, we should have them or not. But that said, I think that the situation with the military bases is ever present, and it hasn't really resolved itself in any form of fashion. Even after 1995, there's been very little progress, right, in terms of reducing the base burdens that Okinawans deal with on an everyday basis. And of course, if you've lived there, which I had the opportunity to do, you see this military presence every single day. It's so ever present in terms of your life. And not even just the US military presence, but even Japanese SDF forces are still so large, even in Okinawa as well. So I would say that lived reality and the lack of any progress in that direction, I would argue, can only continue to maintain a certain level of antipathy and dissatisfaction amongst the Okinawan population. Whether or not that would be solved by the return of the Futenma Air Base or not is a big question. I doubt it, you know, but at the very least, it would be progress that people could look at as a tangible effect of, you know, of things. Ultimately, I think if Okinawans want to have that kind of a system, they need to create it. They need to create an alternative viable structure for governance. And that will be a real question of political will, I think.
Thank you so much for that. And also, just as a follow-up, I was thinking this term realistically, I was thinking about an interview I heard some time ago by Miriam Kaba, who's working in terms of abolition from a Black feminist framework. And it, you know, one of the things that she was saying was that, you know, what seemed completely unrealistic even a couple of years ago has now, you know, in terms of like things like abolition, you know, kind of dismantling police departments, thinking about care in much more expansive ways, you know, and so forth. If you were to ask that question, you know, 2011 maybe, you know, but after George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, et cetera, like all of a sudden these things that seem completely off the table are now really kind of, there's a kind of a surge of that kind of thinking that's really transformational, partially because things have gotten worse in all these different ways, yeah, and the limitations of the state have been seen. So, you know, it's one of the things that's really helpful about your talk is kind of getting me to really think seriously about the ways in which the colonists within is thinking about pragmatism as a default when that's, you know, kind of part of what can kind of hold us back. But I was I'm grateful for the question. So we have a bunch of questions coming in. We have one question here from our online viewers. This is from, I think, Ronnie Weber, who says, thank you so much for the interesting talk. How would you describe recent groups or movements dealing with Okinawan identity? How is the younger generation in Okinawa involved in activism with relation to identity?
I've been very pleased to see a range of different new kinds of formations develop. There was a free university movement in Okinawa in recent years, which was quite exciting in terms of holding community classes around a range of different kinds of issues. There are small groupings of people that meet regularly at times to discuss pertinent political issues. There is definitely an awareness about the endangered nature of the different Ryukyuan languages. And there are many individuals who have taken it upon themselves to really stand at the center of trying to preserve the Okinawan languages. Fiji Baidon, for example, a mixed race, Uchinanchu, has been quite central, for example, as one of the sort of more prominent figures in that kind of movement. Recent years have been exciting, I think, in terms of seeing more and more activity around youth and younger adults reclaiming a sense of their identity and engaging in this process of what we call, you know, datsu shokuminchika, you know, like decolonization, essentially, to try to reclaim a sense of identity and self.
So we have time for just a couple more questions, and so we'll try to keep these slightly more brief, but we have a question from a member of the audience here.
Hi, thank you so much for a great talk. I've learned a lot of, and I'm gonna second other people's voices, like, wow, my colonized education has made me not really aware of Okinawa before, so it was great to hear this. I have one question about, you said, you know, you sort of characterized these drafts as sort of quote unquote unrealistic, and then there were these other sort of conversations about more pragmatic or more realistic possibilities and options. I'm curious if you could speak more about sort of the way these two sort of groups or mindsets communicated or, you know, clashed, and what were some of the ways in which these quote unquote unrealistic or more utopic ideas of the drafts you talked about today influence some of these other sort of more stringent, realistic pragmatists?
Right. Yeah, it's a very interesting question. It's hard to show exactly how the, like, quote unquote, you know, more utopian or visionary plans influence these other plans. But there are, you know, similarities sometimes in the language of some of these plans, which suggests potentially that these scholars are looking at other kinds of materials that, you know, that are being put forward, like these draft constitutions. Some of the more quote unquote pragmatic or, you know, kinds of forms of discussion, for example, occur, for example, in regional autonomy debates, where they are using Japanese law to prove that there's a possibility to carve out a special place in the Japanese state for Okinawans, right? So of course, if you think of like Quebec or you think of Scotland, for example, you know, we can see different kinds of you know, ways in which sort of special regions with a higher degree of autonomy could potentially be developed. And there's an entire trajectory in literature related just to that kind of aspect, which is more framed within the context of, you know, both the Japanese debate around autonomy, which in and of itself is huge, but then also the specificity of how Okinawans themselves are grappling with this kind of a concept. And what we find in some of those drafts that begin to develop, for example, like the Jichiro, the workers' union of Okinawa develops a autonomy draft, which looks a lot like a constitution for an independent state at many levels. It mirrors a lot of what we're seeing here, but it's just framed in a slightly different kind of trajectory in terms of, you know, I think, again, using regional autonomy, I think, a lot more as the framing device to carve out the space for possibility. These drafts, as you can see, they just throw everything out and say, if we had a perfect space to just imagine the best things, you know, what would it look like? And this is what they come up with. Yeah. So it's a little, it's without limits, I guess you could say, without bars.
So I think we have time for one more question. And I apologize to the people online that we have some more questions coming in online. But hopefully there'll be a way for you to see those and perhaps maybe get in contact with Dr. Yokota after the fact. But so last question here from a member of the audience.
Thank you, Dr. Yokota, for that fascinating presentation. So I'm actually very interested in the tensions between empire and indigeneity, especially when they travel abroad to other places like the US or Latin America. And so I read an article by a professor, I forgot her first name, but her last name is Shepherd. She's at Yale University, and she was talking about Fukuokans as also indigenous peoples. But when, I mean, some of them, but when they travel to Korea or to other places in East Asia, they were also shaped by empire. So I wonder whether, I mean, how can we talk about indigeneity coming from Japan when Japan was or is an empire to other places, and whether yes, you could expand a little bit more on that tension. Thanks.
Absolutely, I think it's a very important question, and part of it gets to the root of this definition of indigeneity and of what it means to be an indigenous person, and really the core of it is that for a group really to claim themselves as an indigenous people, they have to have been colonized. They have to have been in control of their territory before another group of people came and took them over. And that is basically the case for Okinawa, which was, you know, a formerly independent island kingdom, the Rukyu kingdom for several hundred years. Regardless of the fact of the dual sort of system of tributary relations that they held with China and with Japan, they still exercised a great deal of autonomy. And that, of course, was changed in 1879 when the Japanese state sent in their military and police forces to Okinawa as a threat of force, kidnapped the king, Shotai, the last king, brought him to Tokyo, placed him under house arrest, and forced him to essentially give over control of sovereignty of the Rukyu kingdom to Japan. And so that, you know, originary sin of colonization holds true for Okinawa in ways that it doesn't hold true for other places in Japan, except for Hokkaido or Izu, which itself was also colonized, but through a different sort of settler colonial paradigm, as opposed to the Rukyu kingdom, which didn't see as much of a settler colonial paradigm as Hokkaido did.
Great. Well, thank you all so much. Thank you so much, Ryan, for the incredibly interesting and provocative talk. I would encourage, I see lots of students from your class are here, and hopefully you can continue those conversations. Also for people online who were kind enough to join us, feel free to come to this talk as well as one next week from Dr. Nandas de Lara Harada, who'll be talking about connections between the question of ethnicity, mestizaje, and then also in these kind of issues in Latin America. But please join me in thanking once again Dr. Ryan Masaki Yokota for his really fascinating lecture today.
Thank you.